Hello, brothers and sisters and Hard Dwells family. May you all receive the grace of supplication and pray to touch the souls who are in need in this hour. Forgive me, this is the same message, but I had to make a few minor corrections. The first correction is that Saddam Hussein used mustard gas and not white phosphorus on the Kurds. And giving last rites to a dying person is not 100% guarantee that they'll be taken to heaven. However, it's a very good chance that they might, because God is so merciful, and it's a wonderful sacrament. I have a few older messages that was meant to go up before this one. However, this is an urgent message and was given to me yesterday. Monday morning, a full-scale war began in Israel when the Hamas militants from Palestine launched dozens of rockets, striking buildings in Gaza and killing many. There's been 80 deaths so far, including 14 children. Father Ezekiel began hurting badly Monday evening, reeling in pain because Jesus was reeling in pain at all the suffering that was going on. Those who were not dead were dying slowly, as the gas from the missiles called white phosphorus were burning the skin off many. Father Ezekiel saw all of this in the spirit. When he went in the spirit, he said the smell was overwhelming as death and decay was everywhere. He had to put a towel over his eyes and nose. However, he saw Jesus right next to him with his sleeves rolled up, cuts on his body, burns on his skin, helping the souls who are still alive. He then asked the Lord what he could do, and he saw a box of talcum powder and zinc, as he was instructed to use it on the souls who are not yet dead, but had been burned by this chemical. One of our intercessors is from India and said the death toll is rising because of COVID now more than ever. 250,000 people in 24 hours have died, and the second wave is hitting Venezuela hard as well. There are also genocide and massacres going on in different nations in Africa, as the enemy is trying his best to throw this world into confusion and our nation into war before things in our nation get overturned. Father Ezekiel has been suffering for all of this intensely for the past few days, and so has Jesus. Yesterday, we got a community call to prayer again for Israel and the war that's raging over there. We were all before the Holy Eucharist and praying several Divine Mercy chaplets. Then I felt prompted by Holy Spirit that He wanted us to go in the Spirit and help those in need in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. Father Ezekiel had told us about 2 weeks ago this was a new mandate from Jesus within our priesthood, that he wanted us to now go to souls and give them last rites and absolution and the Blessed Sacrament to prepare them for a happy death. Last rites are prayers and ministrations given to an individual dying as a way to bring them peace before approaching death. It comes with a confession and then anointing them. And absolution is an act of forgiving someone of their sin, and it's a sacrament of reconciliation from the scriptures, John 20:23. And the Blessed Sacrament is Jesus in the consecrated host. This sacrament is so powerful and a form of purification. When a dying soul receives this faculty, before they pass, they enter into heaven instead of hell, and it prepares their soul to be with Jesus. This is truly an act of God's great mercy on the dying. And use my sanctified imagination to go to Israel. Immediately I found myself in an apartment rubble. Some parts of the apartment was still standing, and other parts had been bombed. I was in one of the apartment rooms, and I felt such an urgency. Holy Spirit brought to my mind to go to the dead first, to absolve these souls of their sins, so that they wouldn't be taken to hell. They had just died. In the first room was a mother and a daughter on the couch, slumped over. I did the sign of the cross over them and said the absolution prayer quickly, and immediately I saw two white lights shoot out of them and upward upon finishing the prayer. I knew it was their soul now taken, and I was amazed. I then went to the next room over and saw a man in rubble, dead. Only his head was sticking out. And I did the sign of the cross and the absolution prayer, and the same thing happened. His soul was taken immediately out and upward. Then went to another room, and this time saw a man blown to pieces. Only his upper half of his body was left. I did the same thing, and his soul was taken upward, I then went to several different rooms as quickly as possible, giving absolutions to those who had just died. Then before I knew it, I was transported to the hospital and found myself running alongside a gurney with a young man on it who was bleeding to death. There were doctors and nurses all around him running alongside his bed, trying to get him into emergency surgery as quickly as possible. I made sure to introduce myself because he was startled to see me. No one else saw me, but he saw me. I told him that Jesus sent me in his great mercy to bring him salvation before he passed. He began to cry profusely, saying he was scared, as the nurses and doctors were hurriedly trying to rush him to surgery and get his vitals into an elevator. He said he never believed in God and was so scared. I told him that Yeshua was the Messiah and what he did on the cross, and if only he would confess with his mouth and believe Yeshua was Lord, he would be saved. He began to shake his head that he believed. I then gave him last rites and an absolution and gave him the Blessed Sacrament right as we entered the elevator. When he received Jesus, he took his last breath in peace and gave up his spirit as the doctors realized he had flatlined and was gone. But I saw him now taken to heaven. Then I was taken to another room with a young man surrounded with family members. His mother was holding his hand crying, and he was in a coma because of his injuries. When I approached the room, he looked startled as I introduced myself and told him of God's great mercy towards him. In the physical, he was a vegetable, but in the spirit, he was able to speak to me heart to heart without words, and his eyes were open. He began to cry because he was so scared. He lived a lewd and lascivious lifestyle in homosexuality. He began to confess all of his sins and shame as though God would never forgive him. But I gently told him to stop because he was sincerely contrite, and Holy Spirit prompted me that he knew all of his sins already and wanted to forgive him. I told him Yeshua would forgive him of all of his sins if he would confess him as Savior and Lord. He cried and cried, saying yes, that he accepted Jesus in his heart and life. I then gave him his last rites in absolution, and although I thought he was going to die, before I gave him the Blessed Sacrament, the Lord surprised me. He prompted me to tell him that he had been given a second chance of life, that the Lord was giving him this second chance to tell the world about his great mercy towards him. As soon as he received the Blessed Sacrament, he took a deep breath and awoke from his coma, as his mother and all his family members surrounded him with tears, and medical staff rushed in astounded at the miracle. I then felt an urgency again that there wasn't much time for others. I then saw my guardian angel Zeal appear, and he told me to grab onto him. And immediately when I held onto him, I was transported in light flashing speed to another room. This one was cold, a low-lit room of a young boy who had just died because of third-degree burns. He was covered in the white sheet cloth and alone. However, I could see his spirit on top of his body, and he was sitting up with his knees close to his chest. Both hands were being pulled left and right by hordes of demons, screeching, saying, "No, he's ours because of the covenant his parents made." The young boy was crying, pleading for me to help him, and that he was so scared because he didn't know what was going on. The room was full of demons. And now as we arrived, it became full of angels as the Holy Spirit prompted me to use holy water, which appeared immediately in my hands, and I sprinkled it all over the demons in the sign of the cross and commanded them to go in Jesus' name. The angels bound them up and they vanished immediately, screeching. The boy was about 9 years old, was sitting up shaking violently as I came and held him in my arms, telling him it would be okay, and that God in his great mercy sent me to bring him salvation. He began to cry as I told him about Yeshua being the Son of God and dying for his sins if he would only believe. I told him to forgive all those who had hurt him and ask for forgiveness for all his sins. He consented, crying as I gave him last rites and absolution. I told him not to be afraid because he would be in heaven with Jesus and that his family would be taken care of. As soon as he received the Blessed Sacrament, I saw an angel of the Lord come and take the young boy to himself. I seen how it glowed brilliantly and was taken to heaven smiling. Then I heard, there is an elderly couple, go quickly. I found myself now approaching a room with an elderly woman in bed dying from smoke inhalation and the gases from the missiles. She had a breather on and her husband was holding her hand in such sadness and tears. He knew he was losing her. I merely knew in my heart by the Holy Spirit that they had loved each other deeply and always wanting to leave the world together because neither could live without the other. When I approached them, they were startled, and I introduced myself to both and told them, in Yeshua's great mercy, he sent me to bring them salvation. The man began to cry profusely, and he held his heart and said, I knew it, I knew it. Yeshua was the Messiah. He was a pious, religious, Jewish man. In the back of his mind, he had always wondered if they had got it wrong. His wife had tears rolling down her eyes. I told them about the cross and the gift of salvation if they would only believe. They both received Jesus in their hearts, and I told the husband that the wife would now go to be with the Lord. But the Lord knew his heart's desire, and in his great mercy had granted his wish, and he too would soon be taken shortly, right after his wife. They both cried and asked about their children. I told them the Lord would take care of them, and they too would be with them in heaven in time. I told the husband he was given a little more time than the wife to testify to his children and others that Yeshua is the Messiah before he be taken. I then gave them both last rites and absolution in the Blessed Sacrament. As soon as the wife received, Jesus appeared with his arms outstretched and nail-pierced hands glowing radiantly in the room. The elderly man was speechless and in tears. Jesus went to the wife and took her soul to himself and cradled her like you would a child. She then was transformed to a young woman in her 20s, now in all white, full of peace, joy, and the radiance of God. Jesus then placed her down, and she rushed to give her husband a big hug. She held him tenderly and kissed all over his face as he was still in shock and utter amazement. She told him how much she loved him, and Jesus came close to the couple, laid his hands on both of them. He told the elderly man not to worry, but he would be coming for him very soon, that where he is, he may be also. Then he took the wife's hand as he disappeared to heaven. The elderly man was still standing in awe when she flatlined. The doctors and nurses rushed into the room, trying to bring the elderly woman back to life, as her husband began to cry with tears of joy, praising Yeshua loudly, over and over again, as the doctors were looking at him bewildered, still trying to revive his wife. He was so lost in what he just experienced and continued to praise God. Then I was brought back to myself as I opened my eyes and I was before the Lord on the mountain. I could feel Holy Spirit's presence strongly all around me, as I felt so relaxed and a warmth I couldn't explain. I kept thinking, Lord, was all of that real? It felt so real as I looked around the room and realized about 30 minutes had passed. My two sisters were just opening their eyes as well. I immediately went to the Bible promises, asking the Lord if what I saw was real, and got Holy Spirit. I was dumbfounded and amazed. My two priestly sisters began to share their stories also of being in Jerusalem. And one even saw me there with some of the souls the Lord was ministering to. We were all blown away by our experiences. I had to go to adoration soon after, as we praised the Lord for what he did with us and through us. When I was in adoration, I was still in awe at what had just occurred, and I began to hear Jesus speak to me. So I reached for my laptop and began writing as I said to him, Jesus, what you had me experience was amazing. It was like I was really there. Jesus began. You were, beloved, and if you think this is amazing, just wait. For did I not say greater works than this will you do? John 14:12. This is one of the many anointings I am releasing to you, heart dwellers. As I promised, new anointings were coming. I'm giving all of you now the grace to receive the anointing to bilocate. This is not a foreign term or concept, but was also given to the early apostles like Philip, when I used him to bring salvation to the Ethiopian eunuch. And here he's referencing to Acts chapter 8, verses 26 through 40. After baptizing the eunuch, Philip was taken by the Spirit of the Lord suddenly, then ending up in another location. Interestingly enough, when I read the entire passage, it also says, "Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, 'Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.'" Verse 26. Guys, that is the location that's being bombed right now, and where Jesus sent us to minister. Amazing. Jesus continued, "Yes, he was transported physically, and that hour will come soon for many of my brides to experience that. But at this time, I'll be using many of you in the spirit, transporting you to different locations as your body may be in one place, and simultaneously at a different location in the spirit. I just need your consent and your faith. It will be faith and charity that is your transport, my beloved ones. You only have to think it, and you'll be there accompanying me, healing the sick, praying for the dying, and helping the dead pass on to be with me. I no longer want you to be comfortable and complacent with just praying for situations, circumstances, and people, but I want you to go there to be with the souls you hear about. If you get a notification on the news of someone dying, someone sick, or an accident that just happened, call upon my spirit, speak in your heavenly language, and use your sanctified imagination and go there. Do not be afraid of what you sense or feel, but if your heart's desire is to see the soul saved, the troubled situation brought to peace in my name, I will transport you there immediately. Once you arrive, be sensitive to my spirit and whom I lead you to. Many will be on their last breath of life, and you will be their only hope. I first want you to introduce yourself. Tell them not to fear, but I've sent you to them. Believe me, they can see you in the spirit. Many times, demons are very close, tormenting many souls before they pass into death. So your presence will cause many demons to flee, because my spirit dwells within you. If you find demons surrounding the soul or your atmosphere, simply call upon my name and do the sign of the cross. They will vanish. If they don't, you can request holy water and will show up immediately. Use that by sprinkling the room or vicinity the soul is in with holy water in the form of the cross, and they will vanish. When you approach the soul, depending on the time they have left, I want you to pray for my mercy. Tell them about the gift of salvation and ask them to believe, have faith in me, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and to forgive all those who have hurt them. Once they respond and consent to receiving me as Lord and Savior, then bless them with the sign of the cross over their forehead, and that will be enough for me to come and take them in my mercy to heaven. For my priests who have this sacrament, you are to give them their last rites and absolution and the blessed sacrament to prepare them for a happy death. Some souls you will be used to revive them back to life. Just follow my spirit and his leading. Others I may take you there to simply pray by their bedside and be a source of comfort and companionship in their fear and loneliness. My brides, you will bring comfort to many souls and touch many lives in this way, but you must believe. I want you to work with me. I need you to work with me. For those who are suffering and confined to bed with a cross of sickness, this is your primary ministry. And to my priests, this is a faculty I'm calling you to now use. As the times get darker, I will need the response of my brides to come quickly and work immediately when this call of prayer comes from a loved one, a prayer chain, or from the news. Accompany me there quickly. With my spirit empowering you and angelic help, you will save a many number of souls in this way. And that was the end of Jesus' message. Amazing. I had never heard of bilocation before until I began to read and learn about the lives of the saints. St. Padre Pio, St. Francis, St. Martin de Porres, and so many others were known to be at two different places across the world helping a soul in need. I've experienced this twice, but if I can be honest, I didn't have the faith to really believe that was what I was doing. With every gift from the Lord, we must be careful to not rise up in pride, but to receive this in all humility and stay in a posture of humility. We don't make ourselves go anywhere. It's by Jesus' invitation, and we just get to accompany him in what he's already doing. My first experience was last year sometime when the Lord called me to a fast. In the evening, he called me to pray in the spirit for a while. As I was praying, I heard bilocation twice, and I rebuked it, thinking it was the enemy trying to puff up my pride. I know I'm a hot mess rebuking the Lord. When I realized it was the Lord, of course, I apologized and waited to see what he meant by that. I then found myself in one of my siblings' house, blessing them as they slept and the children. The next morning, I told her about my experience and, still very much doubting, described what the children were wearing as they slept in the room. I was shocked to find out what I saw was exactly what they had on. Even she was shaken by it. Then Father Ezekiel gave us another call to prayer a few weeks ago and asked me to accompany another priest in the spirit to minister to a young boy who was dying. So I simply used my sanctified imagination and went there as I watched my brother priest administer the priestly sacraments. I just held the boy's hand and comforted him until he passed on. My brother priest and I were at two different locations, and it wasn't until I talked with him that I described in detail what he had done to the boy, and we realized what we experienced was very real. He didn't see me, but I was there the whole time watching him, as he confirmed the specific things I described is exactly what he did in the spirit. So guys, you can go in groups or in pairs in the spirit to help these souls. Anything you need will be immediately there available for you at the first thought of it. Don't limit your imagination or the Lord. This is very real and what he's calling us to do and asking us to correspond to help him in this way. Some may say, I don't see the spirit. Just remember, all you need is a willingness, faith, and the motive of love to help these souls, and Holy Spirit will do the rest. Believe, and use this gift to snatch many souls out of darkness. So please, go to the suffering places, take this call to prayer seriously, and go there daily to minister to those who are still suffering. God bless you guys until the next message.